Coming up on Theater Talk.
You hear the audience, and this is not the first preview, but it's obviously Le Tout New York, because they're not going to miss out on a Fosse Verdon musical. They want to go soon. And they are eating this show up. It's ovation after ovation. They must have thought this is going to be the biggest hit that ever lived. And then they opened, and the critics say, oh, I just don't like this. Oh, I just can't stand it.
From New York City, this is Theater Talk. I'm Susan Haskins, and joining me is my co-host, Jesse Green, co-chief theater critic of the New York Times, and we are so delighted to be joined yet again on Theater Talk by author, historian, and just all-around thinker, Ethan Mordden, author of his latest book. How many books have you written, Ethan?
I lost count.
You've lost count. All That Jazz, The Life and Times of the Musical Chicago, which we're going to talk about in a few minutes. But before we do that, Ethan, I want to remember that I first met you when you were on Theater Talk way back in the day. You were on our second show, and then you were so interesting, you became our second and third show.
Held over.
Yes, and at that time, you had just written here the Rodgers and Hammerstein book, which I cherish. And so when I saw that Carousel was opening in a much celebrated revival, I thought you would be the guy to bring in to set us up about the history of the Rodgers and Hammerstein musical Carousel.
But what I want to do, and I brought a little trot with me so I wouldn't mess it up, is there is a quatrain in the bench scene that was unfortunately cut in Boston.
Now, the bench scene is where
the first couple, Billy and Julie.
We must assume that not everyone has seen Carousel, though.
In the bench scene, it's a big musical scene, about 8 or 9 minutes long, mm-hmm. and it contains If I Loved You, but it's got a lot of other things, underscore dialogue, recitative, and little musical bits. And one of the musical bits that I find so interesting, because I think it's the center of Carousel, is I had to write it down because I couldn't remember, and of course I won't sing it. There's a feathery little cloud floating by, Julie says, like a lonely leaf on a big blue stream. And Billy answers, and two little people, you and I, who cares what we dream? Which is sort of despairing in a way, because this is a show about little people. But the fact is, Carousel, from beginning to end, does care about their dreams, their aspirations. There are two couples, as I say, Julie and Billy, but there's also Mr. Snow and Carrie. And they're interestingly contrasted because Julie and Billy just win us over completely. She's a sweetheart. He's got a lot of problems, obviously a rough upbringing, foster homes, orphanage, and so on kind of thing. He's got a belligerent front. It takes very little to get him going, but especially authority figures. If a cop shows up instantly, he's very unhappy, angry, his ass chip on the shoulder is what they used to call it kind of thing. They're not a good match, but she just falls in love.
Well, let's just stop there for a second. They're not a good match. Right, I get you, but they're also the only match. In another way, she is not a soubrette kind of...
No, not at all. She's deep.
And she's not, in some ways, even, some people would argue, while being the main character, she doesn't even have the most material in the show as
no,
the
she
women
doesn't.
Go.
But you walk out of the show thinking
right.
about those two.
She's a very unusual young woman in a show like that. It must have freaked people out to see, she goes for the dangerous man. She knows something about herself.
Instantly like this. Yes. And you know, at the end of the bench scene, we know they're gonna end up together, but he's lost his place to live because Mrs. Mullen she won't take him back. And Julie is locked out of the mill.
Yeah.
So they're gonna end up in bed together. We don't even know where. I don't know if they even have any money.
But isn't it a quaint thing about the 40s that this huge sexual attraction has to be defined by them talking a long time and singing long songs instead of now when they just, immediately get together and hook up and that would be the end of it.
They have to philosophize about
that's right.
In Showboat, the same thing happens, but that is instant. They sing make believe and they're,
But this is what the show does that other shows don't do, and it's why that scene is arguably the most famous single scene from the Golden Age. Would you agree with that?
Totally, yes. It's mentioned all the time in that
context. It is through their argument and their philosophy that they understand their love. It wouldn't have been enough just to have them lock eyes at the carousel, and then next thing we know, they're, shacking up together. We have to fall in love with them. as they fall in love, and that all happens in that incredible scene. So it fascinates me that there's material that wasn't used. Was there a lot of other material that wasn't used?
To a certain extent, and believe it or not, one section actually ended up on the cast album. It must have been cut after the opening. During the soliloquy that Billy sings near the end of Act One, there's that whole section. A lot of people know it. When I have a daughter, I'll stand around barrooms.
Was the show very different out of town? What was the course of its development?
It was too long. That's what all these cuts were. But it was very different in Boston, well, New Haven and then Boston, in one important way. The scene that we know of with the starkeeper on the bench, it's almost an empty stage.
Let's describe what that is, though.
The starkeeper is, he gives Billy, well, Billy steals a star, actually, but he's pinning stars up. It's God, of course.
And then Billy, Billy has to confront God at some point.
Well, he even sings in a song that is often cut now because it was basically there to change a very cumbersome lot of scenery, The Highest Judge of All. He says, you know, all my life, basically all I've ever seen are, you know, little people like me, magistrates. I want the big guy for my trial in the afterlife. And in fact, he gets him. So he has the starkeeper and the heavenly friend who brings him back to earth to see if he can redeem himself. And in Lilium, the play it's based on by Ferenc Molnár, he fails. And that's the end. Rodgers and Hammerstein added on this marvelous scene in which he goes back to his daughter's high school graduation. And he's supposed to do something or other to make them happy. And it's hard to do when you're dead. But he, you know, speaks to them and he gives them a sense of, you know, again, the aspirations of little people. And in fact, although she's always felt isolated, the daughter is now part of a group. The girl next to her puts her arm around her, like, we're all together in this. It's a community. And the Dr. Selden, who is the speaker at the graduation ceremony, is played by the starkeeper. And the great moment in the original production, which I've never seen in any revival, is as Billy is being led away and the curtain's about to fall, the heavenly friend pauses and looks at Dr. Selden, who nods. And is he nodding at the message of you'll never walk alone, or is he nodding, mission accomplished? And the curtain comes down.
From the time it went on the road to the time it opened on Broadway, did anything of major structural...
Yes, I was going to say that. Originally, this it wasn't the starkeeper. It was, believe it or not, Mr. and Mrs. God in a New England-like parlor. She was playing the organ, and he was the same actor, by the way. I forget his name. Russell... Oh, I forget. He was
but
originally
were
Johnny
new
Johnson.
New characters, Mr. and Mrs. God.
Mr. and Mrs. God. They changed this because New Englanders, this is Boston, the tryout, hated that scene because it was just like New England. And they're used to it, but they don't want anyone knowing about how they live. It went over so badly that Rodgers and Hammerstein, for a rare time, fired the actress who was playing Mrs. God because that was her only role. They didn't have any choice. They had to change the whole scene. They kept the God guy, and then he became the starkeeper. Why call him God? Everyone will know anyway, kind of thing. Russell Collins, that was his name. Eventually, the starkeeper became this kind of star cameo. There was a City Center revival in the 1950s. The billing was, you know, name, and none other than the beloved Victor Moore as the starkeeper. So it's this great role.
I would have loved to have seen Victor Moore. You make the point in here in the book that Lilium took place in Budapest, and they toyed with making this happen in New Orleans, but they didn't want to deal with the accent.
Exactly. Yeah. Also, they didn't really know the culture of New Orleans, and there's a lot of French stuff, and there's this, and there's that. They'll get everything wrong. So they decided everyone knows New England, and that was a great idea because it's like a folk play. You get all this New England stuff, all that dialogue and the accents and the odd little ways, the idioms that they have expressing
themselves. Plus the clam bakes.
Absolutely. What a great second act opener.
We really must discuss, in anticipation of the current revival of Carousel, we have to discuss the thing that has become in the last few years controversial about Carousel.
Yes.
And that is, just to summarize it, one of the things that happens when Billy comes back to see if he can fix his life in a way, or fix the lives of the people he left behind so as to earn credits in the afterlife, is that he
tries to give his daughter a star, and she's afraid of him, and he slaps her hand. Actually, he has hit Julie. Everyone calls him a wife beater. He's not a wife beater. He's very frustrated when people don't understand what he's trying to do. And I believe, this is just my own personal feeling,
that's a wife beater.
I think he is ashamed of himself around Julie because she's so unquestioning in her love for him, and he knows he's not worthy of it. He's a bad guy. And it makes him angrier rather than less angry. She's so nice. At least if she were, you know, if she gave as good as she gets, it would be an even contest. But she's not. She just loves him. And I think he finds that very hard to take.
But it goes even further than that. There's a famous line that Julie says in response to a question from her daughter after this interaction that she has.
It's the line.
Yeah. You want to?
It's something like, can someone hit you and it feels like a kiss, or it feels like he loves you or something? And Julie says, yes, and everyone is. But you know, first of all, people weren't like that in 1945. Actually, the trouble in 1945 must have been for war widows, because you know, a lot of women in the audience had lost their son, their husband, their father, kind of thing. And here's this thing about, you know, your dead loved one. That must be a lot trickier than, not anymore, but it certainly was originally. The fact is, Billy doesn't hit her because he's mad at her. He's mad at himself because he can't ever get anything right. He stole this star, a beautiful gem of a thing, it's usually like this big, to give to his daughter, and she's just afraid.
I haven't seen this version, and I don't want to get stuck on this, but I do have to come in with that that's what women grapple with, that men hit them because they're frustrated, and that now we're going, but, no, that's not a good
reason. No, I'm not saying it's okay, but I'm trying to explain, explain why he behaves this way.
Right.
Instead of saying, all right, if you don't want the star, have a stick of juicy fruit.
I think there is room for argument. What I feel is that's what makes the story compelling and great in a way. That is true. That relationship happens.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
it doesn't do anything to say, no, that doesn't exist. You can't say that. This show explores what that can mean. And there are many women and men who interpret that way.
No,
maybe it's sick.
But of course, I watch Dr. Phil. And I think not having seen this new production, and I so look forward to it, I believe the attitude they're taking is what you're saying, that's real, that's a real thing.
Ethan, I know that Carousel was Rodgers' favorite of his works.
It was.
I don't know what Hammerstein felt.
No, we don't actually. I think Carousel is it's on the short list in my mind of the great musicals. And it's one that you never quite, it's so dense with this odd psychology and these strange characters never before encountered in a musical that we keep coming back to it. It's always fresh. And I think if you keep in mind that the whole thing is about really social, it's about a lot of things, but one of the things it's about is the aspirations of little people and how Mr. Snow rises because he's such a conformist that he's fine up there with the elites, so to say, whereas nonconformist can't go up, can they?
Well, the question of little people really is a good segue for us to talk about Chicago.
It's good, isn't it grand? Isn't it great? Isn't it swell? Isn't it fun? Isn't it nowadays?
Now, Ethan, your new book, All That Jazz, The Life and Times of the Musical Chicago. Why now did you write a book about the life and times of the musical Chicago?
Actually, you know, it's like the question, what gave you the idea for this book?
Yeah.
No one ever knows. They just hit you. You're walking along the street and, oh, I think I'll, you know, that kind of thing. I don't know. It's just, it's such, to me, an interesting show. And it seemed to me that there's this wonderful line of satiric musicals. I mean, the musical generally is sort of subversive and satirical, but there are some that are evening-long satires. The first of them is Strike Up the Band, 1927, closed out of town, then 1930 on Broadway. And there are a few others like that, Finney's Rainbow, for instance, Of Thee I Sing, Let Him Eat Cake. And what I noticed is the really good ones have satiric scores, too. The score, like, think of How to Succeed. All of those numbers are takeoffs on something.
What do you mean by satiric score? You're talking about pastiche?
To a certain extent, but also, for instance, in those three Gershwin political shows with Georges Kaufman, the chorus takes a kind of Gilbert and Sullivan-like, and that's pastiche, too. But they're also, they're very in all the scenes, and they're, you know, I don't like that, or we get along with him, oh, he's completely crazy. It's got that funny, zany American musical comedy spirit of Offenbach, the founder of the zany musical. So, in other words, it suddenly struck me that Chicago is the most satiric of them all in the sense that half the score is pastiche numbers of old-fashioned kind of showbiz icons. Not all the score, just half of it. And I remember in the original production in 75, when they introduced the matron, you know, here comes Mama Mordden, and she was wearing what I always think of as a nurse's outfit, but I guess that's what the matron of a prison wears. But she also had this ratty boa around her neck kind of thing, because she was Sophie Tucker. It's Sophie Tucker dressed as a prison matron, but you've got to have something for Sophie.
If you're good to mama,
yes.
Mama's good.
And that's and yeah. Sophie always sang these mama songs.
In this book, you talk about Chicago, even to go back to the founding of the city in 1833, but then you go to the play that inspired the movie, that inspired the 1975 Fosse.
Well, there are two movies. Remember, there's silent and a talkie.
With Kitty Foyle, yes. With Ginger Rogers. And then you go to the 1975 Fosse musical, which did okay, but it was trounced by Chorus Line. And then you go to the revival, which is still running on Broadway. 21 years later. What happened?
And not to forget the Best Picture Oscar for
yes,
the movie
yes,
musical.
Yes, yes.
What happened? Actually, you have to remember something. Chicago in 75 was regarded as so cynical and so hard-edged that a lot of people felt it was like a guilty pleasure. It was a brilliant production. And it was Gwen Verdon, you know, and Bob Fosse.
Candor and Ebb.
Yes, but they were such an important part of the history of the American musical in the 50s, the 60s, and here it is in the 70s. And everyone knew it was Verdon's last, you know, Broadway musical kind of thing.
What, because she was too old?
Well, yeah, she was like, you know, and she doesn't dance as much as the, you know, her foil, Cheetah, did originally. Because, I don't know, Cheetah's energy never stops. And Gwen was old enough to need that kind of help. But the idea was a lot of people were very uncomfortable. The reviews were not great. They all said, what a high-powered production, but ugly story, ugly people, horrible this, horrible that. But if you listen to the standard bootleg of a preview performance in New York, it's early enough so that a great cut number, which is 10%, the agent, who of course got cut, and you know his part was combined with the matron kind of thing. Poor guy, David Rounds, and he's told, no, we're firing you because the show's too long, and we can get rid of your part and, you know, combine it with matron Mama Morton and so on. But the thing is, you hear the audience, and this is not the first preview, but it's obviously Le Tout New York, because they're not going to miss out on a Fosse Verdon musical. They want to go soon, and they are eating this show up. It's ovation after ovation. They must have thought this is going to be the biggest hit that ever lived, and then they opened, and the critics say, oh, I just don't like this. Oh, I just can't stand this
it
show.
It seems so like mean. It would have been a critical darling. Everything about it.
Yeah, but Fosse, he was the first person to win all the major awards, and they were very angry. They love to tear you. They love to build you up, and they love to tear you down.
You know, it's a score. I go right to the score, of course, but it's more than that. However, it's mostly told in song, and the score has not a single clinker in it. It's really a perfect satirical score, although you say not all of the songs function as that.
Well, all the songs are satirical, but they're not all specific recreations of the old Sophie Tucker. There's an Eddie Cantor number, there's a Burt Williams number, beautifully built on Nobody, his theme song kind of thing. And then there's a Zez Confrey number, and no one knows who Zez Confrey is. You'll have to read
Zez
the book.
Okay, we'll read the book. So the concept for the musical, the thing that makes it what it is that the story would be told, rather than in a regular narrative way, in a vaudeville turn, basically.
Well, they had to, because except for that poor Polish girl who is innocent but still executed, everyone in it is either a hideous sociopath or a loser.
Right.
Amos is a loser. The others are all, they're just exploitative like crazy, or murderers. I mean, so you have to have something that in the Brechtian manner pushes you back a bit so that you don't have to feel guilty for following the... And apparently, there was this early meeting, and it's Candor and Ebb and Fosse, they're the authors. And Fosse says, now how do we do this? And Ebb, apparently, is the one who said, let's remove them by giving the leads vaudeville numbers. So instead of being, they're not character songs, they come out and perform. Is everybody happy? That's Ted Lewis. And he sings a Ted Lewis-like number. So, oh, I don't have to dislike him, because this is old vaudeville brought back to life. No one's guilty of anything. It's all showbiz. And of course, showbiz is the essential metaphor of the American musical. Showboat is about showbiz. Follies uses showbiz as a metaphor.
Well, and showbiz is now the central metaphor of our political system. And I think
I think showbiz is everything. Everything in America ends up being showbiz.
Well, and the point you say that Maureen Watkins, who wrote Chicago the play in what year?
26.
Is making that everything has gone to a presentational, cynical presentational form. She was presciently taking a look at the...
Although, as I recall, they had trouble getting the rights from her because she became a born-again Christian.
That's the legend, and I was telling Susan
true?
Earlier, it's completely false. There was a guy, and he's no longer with us, so I can say this freely. He was in charge of the rights, and from the 1950s on, everyone wanted to make a musical of Chicago, and he saw all these old plays being turned into, like, Mame, Hello, Dolly being turned into hit musicals. And he would get a commission, you know, forever if Chicago went the same way. And she kept saying no. She had her reasons for that. And he got so angry that he decided to create the legend of Maureen Watkins. The legend is that she's this born-again Christian and was a recluse and was an astrologist and wouldn't leave her house. It's completely, she wasn't a born-again anything. She was born to parents who were members of the Disciples of Christ. They're into Bible study. It's a little-known Protestant sect. She wasn't born-again anything. She moved to Florida to be with her parents. They eventually died. And the fact is she turned everyone down because she was sick of the whole thing. Her writing career had not ended up where it should. Chicago was a hit. The next play was a flop. The next play closed in Philadelphia. And the plays after that could not get a contract. Then she went to Hollywood. Some work there, but it still didn't pan out. And she really felt that she, I have to remember something, in her high school yearbook, she was voted the prettiest girl in the class. She is not what you have been told. She was a live wire. And for a woman to go to Chicago in the 1920s to be a reporter, not in charge of the recipes column.
The murders.
But yes, yes. She covered these, you know, the real life figures who became Roxy and Velma. For a woman to do that in that day was very, very unusual. She's a very feisty character.
Still, the second she died, the estate...
Because she had left in her will a codicil saying, if Fosse and Verdon still want to do the musical, they get first refusal. So she really did want them to do the show.
But she didn't want to do it while she was alive.
No, and that's who knows why.
Now, we're almost out of time, but I want to ask you one last question. Many people say that the reason that the Chicago revival in the early 90s, directed by Walter Bobby and with Anne Rankine doing choreography based on Fosse, succeeded was because we'd had the O.J. trial.
Absolutely, which was such pure showbiz. Justice as showbiz is what the play Chicago is about. And keep in mind, too, although the silent movie is very, very different from the play, and to a certain extent, even the talkie remake with Ginger Rogers, because she's innocent, by the way. I won't tell you who actually did it. You'll never guess. And by the way, all right, skip that. But the point is, the whole Chicago thing is a faithful recreation as a musical of the original play. It's the first time that anyone said, let's do the play as a musical, because the two movies are very, very far removed. And the story of the play Chicago is the story of the musical Chicago. They just inserted numbers, they changed things around, all kinds of odd little accents and so on. But it's very, very faithful to what Maureen Watkins had in mind.
Was it ever discussed that O.J., upon his release, would be a terrific...
Billy Flynn.
Billy Flynn.
Jesse.
The lawyer.
But isn't that him?
That would be... life going into art, wouldn't it? Yes, and that would be the ultimate completion of Chicago.
Okay, we've completely freaked Susan out.
You're thinking like the producers of some
Well, you know, the Weisslers who have produced the revival are famous for stunt casting.
That's what I'm thinking.
This would be the stunt of stunts.
Then we'll have Stormy Daniels can play something.
Excellent.
I think, can she dance? Can she sing? They must have had some that don't.
I'm not aware of her talents.
How many times have you seen Chicago?
I saw the original 5 times.
Yeah.
And I've seen the revival about 8 times.
Now, can you just tell us, just a couple, we don't have so much time, your favorite leads?
Best Roxy of all time, of course, Gwen Verdon, because she acted as well as everything. Mm-hmm. She was spectacular. That's why, as I say, all the smart people were at the early previews.
But for the stunt casting?
I wouldn't call this a stunt, but in the revival, I think the best Roxy was Sandy Duncan. Very, very well thought out. Every line was given a kind of spin that she really thought of who this person was, and she looked great. But one I really enjoyed the second time I saw her was Melanie Griffith. The first time, she wasn't quite ready. I think she told her handlers, you know, what's his name? My husband is down the street.
Antonio Banderas.
So get me something on that street in the only other theater in Chicago. So in she went, and she wasn't that great. But I saw her again later in the run, and she was wonderful. And the most exciting thing of all was Liza Minnelli, when she took over, kind of, and they didn't give her any PR. It didn't say, Liza Minnelli is now...
Because Gwen was sick.
Yes. Well, something happened with a feather. Yeah. And so for 5 weeks, and the great thing was, Kander and Ebb thought, could Liza take over? Because otherwise the show was going to die. We can't run it with a, although she was very good, the understudy. And they called Liza and they started to say, you know, what the problem was. And she said, yes. Yeah, when? Thursday? I'm all set to go. And she really was terrific. I took my parents and we were sitting, we had great seats down in the orchestra down front. And just before it began, and every sellout house, of course, it's Liza in Chicago. And the announcement came over, ladies and gentlemen, at this evening's performance of Chicago, we'd like to announce a change in program. Everyone gets, he says, the role of Roxy Hart. And growl starts to come up. He says, usually played by Gwen Verdon, will be played by Liza Minnelli. And now we're really set. And I was telling Susan, there's this quote, Robert Edmund Jones, who designed the Paul Robeson Othello in the early 40s mm-hmm. with Uta Hagen, he said that the audience was so keyed up at the first performance, or I guess it was opening night, that he said, if a cat had walked across the footlights, it would have been electrocuted. That was the atmosphere in that Chicago for Liza Minnelli. She really was wonderful.
Ethan Mordden, thank you so very much.
Thank you.
All That Jazz, Jesse Green, co-chief theater critic of the New York Times, thank you so much.
Thank you, Susan.
Thank you, everyone. And now, because you're talking about Chicago, I get to run my favorite B-roll, Hot Honey Rag, with Anne Rankin and B.B. Newworth. Good night. Thanks to the Friends of Theater Talk for their significant contribution to this production. Theater Talk is made possible in part by the Frederick Lowe Foundation, the Corey and Bob Dinelli Charitable Fund, the Noel Coward Foundation, Carrie J. Fries, the Dorothy Strelson Foundation, and the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs.
We welcome your questions or comments for Theater Talk. Thank you.